This weekend starts right after this.
Great news. There's a quick way you could save money. Switch to GEICO. GEICO could help you get great coverage at a great price, and it only takes 15 minutes to see if you could save 15% or more on car insurance. Go to GEICO.com today and see how much you could save.
From Compass Media Networks, this is America's First News, This Weekend, with your host, Gordon Deal.
Why sex crime victims stay silent so long. I'm Gordon Deal with Jennifer Koschenka. Thanks for spending part of your weekend with us. Here's what's coming up this hour.
Why did the woman accusing Supreme Court nominee Brett Kavanaugh of sexual assault wait for more than 30 years to tell her story?
On the healthcare front, new high-tech advances, giving infants a better shot at avoiding scores of illnesses.
In sports, it appears that in the NFL, you get what you pay for when it comes to kickers. Just ask the Vikings and Browns.
And the most disliked towing company in Chicago gets the boot from city officials.
So this tow company in Chicago has been infamous for a half a century for towing people who were parked legally, for not returning cars, for jacking up the tickets, and for sort of holding them as ransom, holding the cars as ransom, and for just being mean. They have a real reputation for being intimidating and mean.
Wall Street Journal reporter Doug Belkin on how Lincoln Towing Service over the decades became known as the Lincoln Park Pirates. He's here later in the hour. After more than 30 years, Christine Blasey Ford has come forward to accuse Supreme Court nominee Brett Kavanaugh of sexual assault. The two, according to lawmakers, were trying to get to Capitol Hill to testify. Things have changed this past week. One of the questions, though, among many about this development is, why do some women wait to speak up about things like this? Analysis from Dr. Elizabeth Primamore at the City University of New York. She's author of Shady Women, Three Short Plays, which details stories of women living in grief because they could not be their true selves. Elizabeth, help us understand.
Well, I think it takes a lot of courage for her to come out and tell her story. I mean, when I read her letter, I was impressed with it. Initially, I was made perhaps a little skeptical, only because Kavanaugh is 17 years old, and I certainly wouldn't want to be reminded of some of the things I did when I was 17.
Sure.
However, her letter is very powerful. She said something that I think is important. She said it is upsetting to discuss sexual assault and its repercussions. Yet I feel guilty and compelled as a citizen about the idea of not saying anything. And I think there that's the question. Women, in particular, have been in the past. There's been these cultural norms of silence for women, along with a sense of futility. If they speak up about their experiences, no one would listen, nor would they be believed. And I think that has always been the problem in terms of sexual misconduct.
Why is it that you think takes so long, I guess? Because part of me says, wouldn't you begin to repress that terrible moment in your life if that's what happened?
Why did it take so long? Well, I think because it's a sense of futility. Right? No one's going to care what I have to say. No one's going to believe me. And as a woman, traditionally, if a woman speaks up, expresses anger, she's been viewed as unfeminine or not a real woman. So now, which I think is very fortunate, women are speaking, being believed, and not giving in to these oppressive gender signifiers. And we're all seeing it. The female characters in my play My plays have defiant natures, complex moral dilemmas, which help, I think, help them not be silent nor play by the old rules. And that's what I think. The old rules are becoming near obsolete, and the power dynamic between men and women seems to be changing.
Mm. We're speaking with Dr. Elizabeth Primamore. She's an English professor at the City University of New York, also author of a book called Shady Women, Three Short Plays. And we're talking about why women wait to speak up about sexual assault. There's been criticism, as you've probably heard, about the therapist's role in all of this, and perhaps this was dragged out of her, you know, in some sort of at a political manner. Whether that's true or not, to me, you know, is not really the question here. But what about just yet another thing that women have to deal with when they come out?
Well, I think on the more positive side of that, the Me Too movement has emboldened women, and there's the power of building community there. You know, she's not coming out of the shadow, so to speak, on her own. She has a strong community of women supporting her. On the other hand, no one wants to be judged, and it's a very sensitive issue. So I think that's part of, and also, no one wants to be defined by an incident in their life. Including the justice.
Sure.
Nobody wants to be defined by an incident. Nobody wants to be defined, I should think, by a sexuality, by a race, by ethnicity. So I think that's part of the risk also. I think that's part of the reason for the hesitation in her coming out and the problems. It's complicated.
The complications arise, too, when there are false accusations, right? I mean, to go to the other end of the spectrum.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. No, it's definitely a complicated issue. I mean, I certainly don't have all the answers to that, Gordon, but I guess we'll see what happens on Monday, but no, false accusations are a terrible thing also. But in terms of women, in terms of being subject to sexual misconduct, that has been going on for a very, very long time, and it's a sea change in our culture now that women are coming forward, and I think it's an important one.
Thanks, Elizabeth. Dr. Elizabeth Primamore. Again, the book is Shady Women, Three Short Plays. It's 13 minutes now after the hour. On this weekend, glad you're with us. A wave of innovation in newborn care is giving infants a better start in life and could improve Americans' health far into the future. At the same time, researchers are gaining new insights into genetic and environmental influences on the fetus, such as a mother's obesity or exposure to toxic substances. And a growing movement to provide better postpartum care aims to help all new mothers better care for themselves and thus their babies. Wall Street Journal freelance contributor Laura Landreau says, all of which may not only improve health during pregnancy and infancy, but for years to come. Laura, explain.
Well, one of the things, you know, the March of Dimes, which you've probably all heard of, it's been around forever, they're funding these six prematurity research centers, including, you know, one at Stanford University. And so they're trying to identify the causes of premature birth. And one of the things they're finding is that you can go back to a blood test, a simple blood test, and that blood test will help you determine whether this particular mother is at risk of delivering a baby too early. And that baby, you know, obviously, if it's born early, is going to be at higher risk. So what they're trying to do is figure out, if we know this woman's at risk, let's figure out what we can do to prevent it, to slow it down. You know, they actually have certain drugs that can prevent women from delivering too early. However, those drugs, they don't always know who to give them to. Mm. And by the time the woman starts to deliver, it's too late to give them a drug because the baby's coming out. So that's one of the issues that that is very much in the forefront. Another thing that happens is that babies are born prematurely and their little brains can be injured. They might not have enough oxygen. They have lots of reasons that their lungs aren't fully working or their brains are a little more vulnerable. So even if you're a full-term baby, for example, this isn't just premature babies, even full-term babies can, you know, be deprived of oxygen and blood for just a few minutes. You know, they can end up with seizures, they can go on to develop cerebral palsy and other developmental problems. And then there's that risk of long-term problems from brain injury, yeah. Learning disabilities. There's a lot of evidence of this. So they're looking at ways to more carefully monitor those babies as the mothers are getting closer to birth and as they're born.
Mm. We're speaking with Wall Street Journal freelance contributor Laura Landreau. Her piece is called The New Improved World of Infant Care. She's got a look at the technology that is helping babies these days. In the story, too, you mentioned genetics and epigenetics.
Right,
what's the difference?
Right. Well, you know, genetics, we all know the full genome, people are getting, it's getting a lot easier and less expensive to sequence the entire genome of every person. And if you're a baby born now, you'll get a little blood test, it's the HEAL stick, and they screen for about 30 conditions. You know, things that are immediately of a risk, you know, problems with digesting milk or something like that. But what they're talking about doing now at places like, you know, Harvard-affiliated hospitals, the National Institutes of Health is funding this, and they are looking at how you could sequence the entire genome. It's called BabySeq, like baby S-E-Q. And they're exploring whether, is this the right thing to do? First of all, is this the right thing to do? Do parents want to know, you know, what risks their baby might be or might not be at risk for down the road in the future? So they've got about 325 families, and basically they're randomizing them into just getting regular tests or getting the genome sequencing. And they're going to try to follow the kids till they're 18. And the idea is we're going to predict conditions, decide what medications we can use in the future. If we know you're at risk for heart disease, maybe we're going to go much more carefully into checking you every year. You know, there's so many childhood onset diseases that can be caused by a single gene. So if you're aware of that, it doesn't mean that child's going to get it, but you know to watch for things. You know the pediatrician knows, let's keep an eye on this baby. And, you know, epigenetics is sort of, it's kind of one of those complicated scientific things. It's where something that influences the genes, DNA from the outside, and switches these genes on and off, it could tell you something about whether you're going to inherit a trait like obesity.
Wow.
So okay. If there are weight control genes, could they switch those genes from obese to lean with changes that you could make in drugs or supplementing the diet or other therapies? If you know the genes are kind of going to predispose you through something, is there a way to fix that, to tinker a little bit with the genes? And obviously this is all in the future, but this is what researchers are looking at now.
I don't know if you've seen the pictures associated with your online story, but there's a picture of this Embrace MRI system at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston.
Yeah,
it's looks like it's just perfectly molded to hold an infant, you know, in like a little silo to what, scan the brain, and a baby's like completely wrapped and swaddled and looks totally immobile and probably sleeping.
Yes, well, that's the thing. You know, what they've found is that studies have shown that MRI images can really help look at babies' brains to see, first of all, has there been a brain injury, something you could never see from the outside, and the child might not have any outward signs of a brain injury. However, if you put them in an MRI, you can see that.
Thanks, Laura. It's Wall Street Journal freelance contributor Laura Landreau. 22 minutes now after the hour on This Weekend. Thanks for being with us. Time now for a business update, and it's brought to you by the Michigan Economic Development Corporation. If you want to take your business to the top, take it to a top 10 most improved state for business. Michigan, contact michiganbusiness.org today. Do you have the guts to eat a piece of cake at work? Exploding rates of obesity and diabetes have some employers treating sugar like cigarettes. Here's This Weekend's Jennifer Koschenka.
Donuts or fruit? In many workplaces across the country, there's a battle going on between the health nuts and those with a sweet tooth. Rolf Winkler has taken a look at this office dilemma and joins us now. Rolf, aren't sugary treats pretty much an office staple?
Absolutely, and a lot of people think that's the problem.
What are some companies doing to get rid of sweets?
Oh, I don't think companies are doing anything very aggressive. Our story was mostly about people inside the office who are probably trying to use a little bit of soft power to remove the donuts, the cookies, the birthday cake that always seem to be around right in the middle of the office where it's very hard to walk past it. You know, it's 3 o'clock. You didn't have a donut in the morning, but your willpower starts to break. And that's the time you might get a coffee and you're walking past the break room and, oh, you just got to reach for the donut.
I was going to say, is it probably more of the leftovers just sitting around than actually sitting down and joining together and having cake?
Oh, probably. I think generally in most offices, it's hard to get a survey here, but I think in most offices, people bring treats and they sort of leave them in the center of the office, or they put them in the break room, or they just have them there for people to grab, which most people say, what's wrong with that? There's nothing wrong with that. And a lot of those people are right. You know, if you don't want to eat it, don't eat it. And other people say, well, gosh, you know, at a certain point, it's like secondhand smoke. It's like cigarettes. Temptation is hard to resist, and I don't want to be exposed to to secondhand temptation here.
It would have to be seriously a problem, though, for some people who are already struggling with their weight, no?
Well, that's just it. And you actually, it's funny, the reaction to my story breaks along a couple lines. There are some people who say, you know, oh, this is too politically correct. What are they going to come for next? My coffee? And then there's others that say, please get rid of it. But when you think about it, for the former, one thing to keep in mind is, it's not just a problem for people who overeat. It's also a financial problem for everyone, if you do the math, in 2016 or 2017, the U.S. taxpayers each paid